This week, we can go a little bit slower, you know. Not as much really happened in this week. Not as much movement in the power rankings as we've seen previous. So this one probably will be quite a bit shorter, just due to the big teams won, the small teams lost. I went 7-0 on ELF Live predictions, which kind of says a lot about quite, not like predictable, it was quite an unpredictable week in some games and results. But I think the winners were quite predictable. So not a crazy amount of movement in the power rankings. We'll get straight to it. Don't want to mess around too much. Don't forget to like, subscribe, view some of the other stuff if you haven't caught up. You know, we've had quite a lot of people come in that are quite new due to ELF Live. Hopefully that'll be going on today. This probably is going to be the same release day as ELF Live. So let's just get straight into the power rankings and just see where everyone's at. We're nearly at the mid-season. Can you imagine that? Crazy. So let's just get into the power rankings. Don't want to waste too long talking about nothing. All right, moving down one. Prague Lions. You release your quarterback, Kyrie Lyles. You don't get in a new one at all. Like, they didn't have a homegrown in there. They didn't have a backup American in there. They had Radeem Kallios, Devera Fields Jackson. That was the two guys they had in, and that was something. I mean, they lost 34-7 to the Berlin Thunder. It's better than I thought they would have done. Granted, they had that long touchdown with Devera Fields Jackson, but it was never gonna win. They were never gonna win. Like, it was pretty obvious. They go to 0-6. Where do you go from here, man? The offensive line's still awful. You don't have a quarterback. You're gonna have to get a new one in. It's the same thing from last year. It's exactly the same thing from last year. So they've got quite a lot to prove. They just kind of lack direction. They do have good talent on that roster. It's just not come together. They look pretty poor. Their offensive line's awful. They don't have a quarterback. So kind of a tough one for them. Moving up one though, Helvetic. They did lose badly to the Surge, but they have a quarterback. So it's the only reason why they move up one. And like I said, we wouldn't have had any movement in this top 10 if it wasn't for this. So Helvetic go to 0-5. You know, they've been poor, very poor, again against the Surge. I have a lot of thoughts about the Mercs, and I don't want to get too much into it because I'll get too frustrated in this video. It'll just be a random video. But you're playing DBs at receiver, you're playing receivers at DB. You're gonna hurt AFB if you keep playing him at safety. Like, he's a great receiver. You got Strater playing at receiver, you got Barnes playing at receiver. Like, what are we doing, man? Like, are we playing football or are we messing around? I'm gonna be honest, like, it was poor, really poor performance. The offensive line's still terrible. I've said before, I believe in Carl Nagan. I know he had a bad game. But I believe in Kyle Nakin. The offensive line is just an atrocity. You could find more offensive line quality probably in the crowd of that game at Stuttgart. Like, it was really bad on all levels. So they do move up one. The positive was that they scored once. And they have a quarterback. That's the only reason why they're above the last place. But honestly, I'm very frustrated with the Mercenaries. I'm not even a fan of them, and I'm frustrated about the direction. You know, I want them to succeed, I really do, but they're really not making it easy for themselves, just within the organization, and the decisions they continue to make week by week are just baffling. You know, it's almost like they're missing an all-ear left corner when they're getting torched by backup players. They were getting torched. Stuttgart had all their, like, main people out in the first half, and they still managed to score with ease with the backups in. So kind of proves Stuttgart's depth, also proves how bad the Mercenaries are. Not very much movement for Hervar, stay at 15. They lost in a close one to Milan, but they've still never won, so they're gonna stay there. Dragons lost pretty convincingly to the Raiders. They stay exactly where they are. Milan moved to 3-3. And I think some people are going to expect them to be higher because they went 3-3. But you got to look at the competition they're playing. You know, they've beat Enthroners, they beat the Mercs. You know, it's not the most high quality of wins they have under their belt. So that has to be taken into consideration. They are 500, which I wouldn't have thought. You know, I did actually have them kind of high up in the power rankings of the preseason, and then they dipped to like last when their offense was an atrocity, and they've moved back up to where I expect them to be. They have a cakewalk of a schedule. you know, it was a 19-14 victory against a bad team. There were chances for them to go a little bit more ahead. There was chances for the Andronas to win. So it was an interesting game. Like, it really was. And they moved to 3-3. I think they can take pride in that, I think. You know, are they going to win any more games for the rest of the year? I don't know. They do have the Andronas again, so probably. They've not improved from last year. Actually, defensively, they massively improved from last year. The defense is actually still pretty good. You know, they're a 3-3 team. But they're the best of the bottom, you know, section, I think is the best way to put it. Heading into the more medium section, Cologne go 1-3. Some people are going to think Milan are above Cologne, but Cologne put 25 points up on Paris. It was their defense that was the problem. They, you know, conceded 60. It's quite the problem. But Cologne do have some talented players in the positions. Their passing game is still really bad, though. Like, they really can't get it started. They've made the switch with Carlos Hill, and he had some flashes. But overall, they got a lot of stuff to figure out. Gerald Almond is still a good running back. The offensive line, though, is not great. The passing game is bad. Like, I don't really know what decisions you're going to make going forward regarding that. Whether that's trying to find a secondary receiver, because they don't really have that secondary receiver. They lost Paul Lenhart last year, which was a big dent. I think that really went under the radar for most people, is they lost a very, very talented slot and safety outlet, and they also lost, you know, a bunch of other players, and they were that lucky this year that they would have had if it wasn't for the CFL global draft. They're 1-3. They've had some tough competition. I think they do beat everyone below them, though, so that's the reason why they're above. They do have some guys on that team, and they're in such a tough conference, so they're going to only be playing the best teams, and that's always going to be against them in that regard. Wroclaw at 11. I mean, where do you start? They got ripped apart for the Vikings, 37-25. Urib doesn't look like the guy's going to lead into the championship. The run game was on. The defense was bad. It just got ripped up. Like, it does have a good centerpiece of AJ. You know, he's still a defensive player of the year nominee, maybe even an MVP nominee, depending on who you ask. But it's just 2-4, man. Like, it's really bad, considering how much hype they came into the year with. For them to have that record and sit 11th in the power rankings is really poor. Really poor. Their passing defense could stop anything. And that was the point that highlighted during the week, was they have a bad passing defense. And that showed again. No, Torre ripped into pieces. That's a really good pick for me for Rookie of the Year. I'm happy that he's doing well. Reese Horn looks great, and I guess this is more Vienna, but they tore apart Wroclaw, and their passing defense is bad. Their run defense is fine. Their offense is lacking creativity again. Like, it was so good at the start, and it took a bit of a dip, and it took a bit of a dip, and it took a bit of a dip, and it took a bit of a dip. Like, it just keeps going down every week, and I don't really know what the answer with that is. Matt Cole's injured again. Like, a player that I really thought was going to be one of the best receivers in the league, a proper breakout. He's played like one game, two games. He's been on an IR twice. So, that's a problem. It's a real problem. Wroclaw need consistency. That's what they need. They just need some kind of consistency. They've lost to Vienna twice now. You know, they could have lost a couple of more games. Granted, they could have won them too, but they've got a tough schedule up ahead. They've got some easy wins they could pick up in the future with, you know, with that conference being quite weak. But playoffs are looking like a unlikely scenario, and a lot of people expect them to be contenders and then might not even make the playoffs. So between them and Munich, who's been the most disappointing, but I think the Panthers have been the most disappointing personally. I really expect them to be good, and they're not. They're really not. Like, they just can't really get much going, to be honest. Like, it was just a poor game all round. They didn't capitalize. They got torn up on a passing game. They got torn up in a running game. They nearly got 40 dropped on them by a team that has just had a new quarterback turnover because of injuries. And, you know, he's back, and they replaced Epler. So Epler out, Ben Holmes in, who doesn't have the same recognition with some of the receivers maybe after a couple weeks out. And he's still put up 40, nearly 40 points. So Wroclaw 4-11. Very disappointing. Hamburg stay at 10, they could have beat the Galaxy. They didn't, but they could have. Let's talk about Galaxy as well. So that was 9. So Galaxy's 9, Hamburg at 10. What the fuck? What's this game? I said before, the drive-ending turnovers need to stop. And they keep happening. They keep happening. Luke Zaratka was very poor in this game. I'm going to be completely transparent. 2 goal line fumbles. Pick 6. And then a pick in at the end to give Hamburg a lifeline. Hamburg very nearly won this game. I streamed it. You can see my whole reaction. Hamburg very nearly won this game. They just don't have an offense. They do have a good defense. That's been kind of proven. Like a bend, don't break. You know, they had a few instances where they got kind of pushed away with the run game. But Frankfurt finally scored. They seem to be relying on the run game more. I was screaming at stream, like, just run the ball. Keep running the ball. Sandro played well. He scored his first DLF touchdown, which is cool. Just run the fucking ball. And they keep trying to pass it in a red zone. I don't know what they're doing. I don't know who the play caller is, why they're so committed to passing in a red zone. It's not working. Stop doing it. Pivot. The run game. Please use the run game. You're a former NFL practice squad running back. And if you don't have him in, you've got a couple of good complementary running backs you can use too. With like Santos and Fishback. But they're just not using them. And they scored 1 rushing touchdown in their 4 games. Multiple turnovers. Gave Hamburg an opportunity. Hamburg, though, cannot move the ball offensively. Javarian Smith was doing Javarian Smith things where he'll, like, you know, struggle for 2 downs and then fucking run for that 3rd and 18. Like, that's just one example of many of them. You know, the Javarian Smith still confuses me. I don't think he's a championship quarterback, but it was 2 teams. It just seemed like they both were nearly losing it. They both go 2-2 and they finish off the 9-17. Not very much movement. Literally the only movement in this is Prague going down and Helvetic going up. Like, it was not a massively eventful week in terms of movement. Heading into the top 8, Munich didn't play, so they stay at 8. Berlin beat up on a really bad team. They looked fine, you know. They looked convincing. They looked comfortable. They didn't really need to bust out any of the deeper stuff, the playbook. So they looked comfortable. They go to 3-3. They still didn't really, you know, do that well in the second half, but can't really complain. They did enough to win, and they stay at 7. The Raiders Tyrol, again, 32-0 in the Dragons. Comfortable. Expected win. 5-1, so playoff likely. You know, I think as it stands at the moment, they're very, very, very much in the playoffs, which I would not have expected them to do. They've also got an easier schedule, which is true. You know, so did Munich. Munich got the easier schedule, and that's all the Raiders fans like to mention. Oh, you know, Munich have got an easier schedule. I know they do. I know they do. But the Raiders are 5-1. They're just on the outside looking in at that top 5, which is, you know, they don't have that. They do have the statement win over Munich, but Munich have been bad, so I think it's kind of a bit odd. Like, if you told me they beat Munich at the start of the year, I'd be like, oh, that's kind of mad. But, you know, Munich aren't a very good football team at the moment, so it's kind of difficult to grade them off of that. Again, they look fine, and Cozy Perry, more confidence. He's kind of building up, and the run game is still sublime. Bonatti actually is doing incredibly well. Told everyone to get him in fantasy. They got a great rushing offense. Honestly, a really, really, really great rushing offense. And I think that does give a lot of people in that top 5 a problem if they had to play them in the playoffs. I think it gives Madrid a problem. I think it gives Paris a problem. I think it gives Vienna a problem with their injuries. I think it gives Ryan a problem. And I think it gives Stuttgart a problem. Raiders are dark horse. And I wouldn't have expected that at the start of the year. I was wrong where I thought they would be at this point of the year. I thought they'd be maybe 2-3 or 3-2. Or, you know, 3-3 or 4-2 or, you know, something like that. They've done better than I expected them to, and they've done well. You know, I get a lot of people saying, "Oh, you never talk about the Raiders. The Raiders are, you know, 5-1. You barely even talk about them," which is fair. You know, I don't, because they kind of fall with Hamburg. It's like they do good, but they do good against bad teams, so they don't really ever hit the headlines, as it were. Moving down 1 to number 5 is the Madrid Bravos. They lost their first game against the Rhinefire, 40-15, and it was not even close. Ryan Fire very obviously came out with a statement win of like, we want to beat you up. And Madrid really struggled to stop the run, couldn't stop Glenn at all. You know, they had a few moments with interceptions. They got called back or they fumbled, and that could have changed the outlook of the game. They just couldn't stop Glenn. And granted, no one really can at the moment. He looks on fire, you know, but, well, if you pardon the pun, but he looks incredible. And it's hard to stop. And Madrid couldn't do it. They're still without Alessandro. They're not at full strength necessarily. Duncan looked gun-shy again. I hate to say it, you know, I'm a Duncan fan, but same thing with Vorstav at that last game with them. They were behind, they were losing quite badly. The game wasn't going great for him, and then he started becoming gun-shy and not picking his spots. We saw the same thing on the weekend, which is a concern. You know, you never want your quarterback to start becoming gun-shy. He made some poor decisions, which was something on the tape from beforehand, that he makes poor decisions. But he became a lot more gun-shy in this one. Wasn't really letting it rip like he was when they were winning. And it was never really in competition. So they moved down one. Paris move up one. The Musketeers, you know, as I mentioned, they put 60 on Cologne. It was a good statement win on a rival, you know, a division team. They're defensive backs look incredible, as I mentioned 100 times. I mean, Kalani did really, really well. The run game was on. Zach Edwards, hit miss, but mostly hit, you know. The defense allowed 25. Well, you know, they didn't really allow 25 because of the pick six from Cologne, but it was a good showing. They move up one. I don't think they did enough to really upset the order too much, but they did good. They won quite comfortably, so they move up one. Top three. Who do you reckon is top three? Let me know down below. Timestamp it. Who do you reckon is top three? At number three, I think the one's going to annoy people. Vienna Vikings. Hold on. Give me a minute. Let me explain. I know they're 6-0. I know they're 6-0. I know they beat Wroclaw. I know that. They look great. They do have a lot of injuries. They have a lot of injuries. They have two defensive backs that are currently out. And they beat Wroclaw without defensive backs. I know that. They're very, very good. They're an amazing team. I love the Vienna Vikings defense this year. But they have a lot of injuries. Two there on defense. They have a conundrum. They got to sort out with a receiver, Weston Carr. Or do you go Rhys Horn? I go Rhys Horn. I don't think Weston Carr is a top 10 receiver. I think that Rhys Horn is. You've got quarterback situation where both of them are dressed. You know, Epler. Do you go Holmes? The team's going Holmes. But like Epler, you know, it's a good quarterback. Holmes had a bad game. You know, maybe they'll be looking the other way. But he didn't. He had a good game. He threw a pick early, but it wasn't like the be-all end-all. He threw 52 times on a bad passing defense, and it made the stats look a lot better, you know, because they are a bad passing defense. But those injuries, man. Hunter Nichols, Xavier Edwards, that's some big losses. We had a couple guys over in the North America for the under-19, under-20 rather championships. They did good. But they dropped one. I'll be real. And number two, Ryan Fire. Hold on again, because I know people could be typing. Ryan Fire beat a team within the top five, which no one else in the top three has done. They looked a lot more convincing. They've got probably the lead MVP favorite with Glenn. They've improved. They're 5-1. They beat a team that beat them, which gives them a lot of momentum. And I go off momentum with these power rankings. You know, I'm to be honest, I massively go off momentum with these power rankings. So Ryan Fire move up. They're now 5-1, taking the best team in the best conference, which I think means a lot. They've had a lot of really big games. They've beaten nearly all of them. You know, they beat Madrid and they lost to Madrid, but they've also beat Paris. They beat Frankfurt. You know, these are big wins. So, and they beat Cologne. So I'm going to put them at number two. Number one remains the Stuttgart Surge. And, you know, usually I'll be a bit more like, oh, they'd be up in a bad team. But the fact they had the backups in a halftime and they still ruined the starting mercenaries group is very impressive. Riley's an MVP favorite. Geyer's just got a single, I think the most touchdowns for the franchise. They're a really, really good team. They didn't even have to play full strength, and they beat the brakes off of the Mercenaries. It wasn't even close. So that'll round that out. They stay exactly where they are with a big win. Ryan Fire move up. Couple plays. You know, there's not really much movement in this one at all, to be honest. That's why this one's a lot shorter. Let's finish off with the overall picture. All 17 teams. Prague, last. Awful. No quarterback. Directionless. Mercenaries, same thing. Just, they don't have an offensive line and they're directionless. The Androners can't catch a break. They still lose. Barcelona lost badly again to a team that's kind of had their number. They got kind of lucky with a couple of their wins, let's be real. Milan, 3-3. They move up to 13. To 3-3, but they're the best of a bad bunch. Cologne got kind of, you know, manhandled, but they've still got some talent. They're in a really tough conference. They've had a tough schedule. Vorstab at 11. Really disappointing. Another big loss against a team that they would have expected to compete with. Hamburg at 10. Nearly got a comeback. Good defense. Bad offensive performance. Again, they can't really seem to move the ball. Galaxy tried to lose. They go at 9. Tried to lose. Munich didn't play this day. 8. Berlin. Good performance. Comfortable on a really bad team without Gorberg. Reyes Tyrol. 6. Good performance on a bad team. Nothing really to write home about. Braavos moved down to 5. Tough loss. Got kind of dominated by the teams that are going to be in the championship contention, which is interesting. Number 4, Paris. Big win. Comfortable. Didn't really ever look in doubt on a division rival. Vienna fall. But are still one of the best teams. But they just have injuries. Hence the fall. Fire. Bounced back after their loss to Madrid with a statement win, which was more dominant than Madrid beat them by. So they split the series, but I'm going to have them at 2. Still got a 1. And that's going to round us out. Not as busy the week, you know, quite quiet, which is good for me, I think, because I've got a lot of work to do this week. I'm going to be trying to grind out as many videos as possible and try and do, like, complete the Chad video today. Got a little bit more tape on him from this game just gone, which is good. Yeah, a couple of things to reinforce the narrative of, like, my evaluation report of, like, okay, yeah, certain stuff as I've seen in the last couple of games. Sounds good. London 1 still making it. You know, I haven't really filmed much of the retakes and stuff, but I need to get that done. Once I get Chad's ones out, because that's, like, more important, I think, for me to get those consistent videos out and the evaluation reports. This one was quick. I'll be on ELF Live tonight. I'll have what the teams have to do to win tomorrow. As per the weekly schedule. And then hopefully Chad Wednesday. That's the hope. I'm going to try and do that all the day and then finish it up and then have it ready for Wednesday. But we'll see. Much appreciated. Thank you, everyone. Today's good. The next couple of days are going to be the same with releases, by the way. You know, I can't say too much, but I think a few Darius St. Robertson just got released by Munich. There's going to be a lot going on. You know, stay sharp because it's going to be going insane. See you guys later. Thank you very much. See you tomorrow. See you on the ELF Live. Goodbye. Thank you very much. Thanks for tuning into the streams too. It's been good. And we've got a lot more guys coming into streams. I think we were like 8 to 10, which is really, really nice. I like to have more community. So thank you very much. Goodbye. See you later. Bye-bye.